Good evening, Crazy Faith, and welcome to Sunday Service. Thank everyone for being here with us today. It's been almost a year since things started to shut down due to the pandemic, and we really do miss being in person, but we're so appreciative that everyone has tuned in and worship with us for this long. And when we are back in person, we will continue to live stream, so we hope that you will continue to watch with us. So thank you for being here. Just yesterday, the Senate passed a COVID relief bill, so hopefully that means that many of you may be receiving some much needed relief from a stimulus check. So praise God for that. We pray for all those watching today that God continues to manifest blessings in your life, and we pray for God's presence in the lives of our friends suffering in any way. We know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning, and morning always comes. And we praise God anyhow. We praise him, we say hallelujah, because he is worthy to be praised.
Thank you. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is God that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. So enter into God's gates with thanksgiving and enter into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto God and praise God's holy name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endures to all generations. Praise ye the Lord.
And now we pray the prayer that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ taught us to pray when his disciples asked him, Lord, how do you pray? And he answered, you pray like this. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, hallowed be thy name. On earth as it is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. On earth as it is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Give us this day our daily bread, hallowed be thy name. Give us this day our daily bread, hallowed be thy name. And forgive us all of our trespasses, hallowed be thy name. As we forgive those who trespass against us, hallowed be thy name. And lead us not into temptation, hallowed be thy name. But deliver us from all that is evil, hallowed be thy name. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, hallowed be thy name. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, hallowed be thy name. Amen, amen, it must be so, hallowed be thy name. Amen, amen, it must be so, hallowed be thy name. Amen, amen, it must be so, hallowed be thy name. Amen, amen, it must be so, hallowed be thy name.
Good evening, Crazy Faith. This evening's scripture comes from 1 Samuel chapter 10, verses 1 through 9, and chapter 13, verses 1 through 14. I will be reading from the New International Version of the Bible. It reads as follows. Then Samuel took a flask of olive oil and poured it on Saul's head and kissed him, saying, has not the Lord anointed you ruler over his inheritance? When you leave me today, you will meet two men near Rachel's tomb at Zelzah on the border of Benjamin. They will say to you, the donkeys you set out to look for have been found. And now your father has stopped thinking about them and is worried about you. He is asking, what shall I do about my son? Then you will go on from there until you reach the great tree of Tabor. Three men going up to worship God at Bethel will meet you there. One will be carrying three young goats, another three loaves of bread, and another a skin of wine. They will greet you and offer you two loaves of bread, which you will accept from them. After that, you will go to Gibeah of God, where there is a Philistine outpost. As you approach the town, you will meet a procession of prophets coming down from the high place with lyres, timbrels, pipes, and harps being played before them, and they will be prophesying. The Spirit of the Lord will come powerfully upon you, and you will prophesy with them, and you will be changed into a different person. Once these signs are fulfilled, do whatever your hand finds to do, for God is with you. Go down ahead of me to Gilgal. I will surely come down to you to sacrifice burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, but you must wait 7 days until I come to you and tell you what you are to do. As Saul turned to leave Samuel, God changed Saul's heart, and all these signs were fulfilled that day. Chapter 13. Saul was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned over Israel 42 years. Saul chose 3,000 men from Israel. 2,000 were with him at Michmash and in the hill country of Bethel, and 1,000 were with Jonathan at Gibeah in Benjamin. The rest of the men he sent back to their homes. Jonathan attacked the Philistine outpost at Geba, and the Philistines heard about it. Then Saul had the trumpet blown throughout the land and said, "Let the Hebrews hear." So all Israel heard the news. Saul has attacked the Philistine outpost, and now Israel has become obnoxious to the Philistines. And the people were summoned to join Saul at Gilgal. The Philistines assembled to fight Israel with 3,000 chariots, 6,000 charioteers, and soldiers as numerous as the sand on the seashore. They went up and camped at Michmash, east of Beth-Aven. When the Israelites saw that their situation was critical and that their army was hard-pressed, they hid in caves and thickets, among the rocks, and in pits and cisterns. Some Hebrews even crossed the Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. Saul remained at Gilgal, and all the troops with him were quaking with fear. He waited 7 days, the time set by Samuel. But Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and Saul's men began to scatter. So he said, "Bring me the burnt offering and the fellowship offerings." And Saul offered up the burnt offering. Just as he finished making the offering, Samuel arrived, and Saul went out to greet him. "What have you done?" asked Samuel. Saul replied, "When I saw that the men were scattering and that you did not come at the set time and that the Philistines were assembling at Michmash, I thought, 'Now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not sought the Lord's favor.' So I felt compelled to offer the burnt offering." "You have done a foolish thing," Samuel said. "You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you. If you had, he would have established your kingdom over Israel for all time. But now your kingdom will not endure. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart and appointed him a ruler over his people because you have not kept the Lord's command." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of his holy word.
Let us pray. Thank you, God, that we can rely on you to be a mountain and a resource when we feel depleted. We thank you, Lord, that your word holds firm, that we can refer to it, we can rely on it, we can stand on it. We thank you, Lord, that you care about us, that you care about what happens to us. And we thank you, Lord, that you intercede and intervene in our lives according to your will. So, God, we pray for this service and we pray for your spirit to be amongst us. God, help us to welcome in your spirit and to respond to your spirit and go forth and do the work you've called us to do. God, we do thank you and we praise you for this day. And we thank you and praise you for the ability to gather together, even if remotely. Bless this word. May it find good soil in our hearts, take root and grow. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, so I could tell everyone I know. You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life so I could be free, so I could be whole, and I will tell everyone I know. Changed my life. And everyone I know. Forever, I'll give glory forever, 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 because you deserve it forever, you deserve it forever, I'll worship forever, I'll worship, because I am free, because I am whole, and I will tell everyone I know who thought I was worth saving. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping. Yes. So you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for. You thought I was to die for.
You better sing, girl.
You thought I was to die for.
Good afternoon, Crazy Faith. I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad you're here with us on this first Sunday of March in the year of our Lord, 2021. We are moving. The COVID relief bill was passed yesterday. The Senate is making progress in some things that are going to help all of us, and I'm certainly glad for that, and I hope you are too. So, you know, we have reasons to be thankful, even though we've been through some times and are still going through some times. But pray with me for a few minutes on this subject. Don't mess up a good thing. Don't mess up. Don't mess up a good thing. You know, too often happens that we don't know what we have until we've lost it. We mess up good things all of the time. Why do we do that? Why is it that so often or too often we can't only appreciate what we have, but also we also spend way too much time looking over the fence at what somebody else has to see what they have and decide that if what they have is better than what we have? We have within us a spirit of insatiability. When we have a lot, it seems like we want more. For example, if we have money, even if we are very wealthy, we want more, and we will do all that we can to get it. That part of the human spirit affects all of us, but it is the bane of existence for those who struggle with an addiction to gambling. I remember going to Las Vegas with some friends years ago, and one of my friends was a gambler, but I didn't know that before this trip. Anyway, we had spent some time with the slot machines. You know, I was and am too cheap to put too much money in them. But, you know, it is addicting if you put a quarter in the machine and get $60 back. The machines are designed to cater to the weakest parts of the human spirit. I saw that and actually did move to machines that seemed to have greater output than any of the ones that I was at. I was looking over the fence. And I would move to different machines, which did not produce for me. My cheapness actually saved me, but I could see how people get drawn in, get pulled in. If you hit the jackpot, you want to hit it again and again and again. Anyway, in our group, we had a gambler. When we had exhausted our little quarters or whatever we had budgeted to pay, we were ready to go. But he wanted to stay there and go to the blackjack table. And I can remember his wife warning him not to lose too much money, but he didn't pay much attention to it, apparently, and I certainly didn't. But hours passed, and our friend was still at the blackjack table. And finally, it was time for dinner, and we all went down to get him so that we could go to the restaurant together. On our way to the place where he was playing blackjack, we saw him come out. He emerged, and he was walking toward us, and I'm going to tell you what, he did not look good. In fact, he looked sick. It turns out that he had gambled away the down payment for a house that he and his wife had just purchased. The money was gone. It was gone. And it turns out that he had had a stream of good luck, raking in triple the amount of the down payment. But he wasn't satisfied. The more he got, the more he wanted. And so he kept trying and trying to win more money. And of course, he kept losing and losing and losing until finally he had spent all of the money designated for the down payment for their house. Needless to say, he and his wife did not join us for dinner. I don't know how they survived the rest of the days that we were in Las Vegas because he had used all of their money. He had a good thing. triple the amount of the down payment for his new house, but he lost it. He lost it. He messed up a good thing. And we all do that, maybe not through gambling, but probably all of us have a story of how we had a good thing and messed it up, thinking that we could get something better. We do things like cheat on a faithful husband or wife or partner, but we don't worry much about it when we're there because we believe that we can get another good catch. We think that they are plentiful and they are not. Do you remember that song by the Shilites? Have you seen her? And I don't know the story of what happened, but the lyrics lead me at least to believe that he had a good thing and messed it up. We don't know if he cheated on her or just didn't treat her like the way she knew she needed to be treated, but she got tired and she left. And the brother is sad and he sings, have you seen her? Tell me, have you seen her? She not only left, apparently, according to these lyrics, she disappeared. And now he realized how good she was for him. At the end of the song, the lead singer says, you know, it's fine. I thought I had her in the palm of my hand. Why do we do that? Why do we so frequently mess up the good things in our lives? One reason is because we do not appreciate what we have or who we are. We take our good things for granted. In the examples that I just gave, the perpetrators did not appreciate what they had. When we do not appreciate what we have, we take it for granted. And those things, and we believe that those things are easily had and easily replaceable. Things that are so good, things that are so good that we think that they will always be good. I know I've been guilty of thinking that. And if we happen to lose what we have, we will always be able to get it. That's what we think. And we think we'll get it back immediately. What we have is often a gift, though, that we did not earn, which is the definition of grace, actually. A free gift that we did not earn, but we take gifts for granted. Having good things that we did not earn makes us act as if we are renters of our own lives. And if something is wrong, the divine landlord will come and fix everything. But we forget that landlords in general are not known for the most part for being benevolent. And life as a landlord is not different. God gives us gifts, or if you want to say it another way, God gives us gifts that we did not earn. That once we mess up and lose them, neither God nor life replaces those things in the way that we thought they would. Having good things in our lives dulls our capacity to appreciate them and protect them and cherish them and realize how precious they are. We move through life like spoiled children, pouting when, after we mess up, we don't immediately get our way again. In the debacle of the January 6th insurrection, those arrested are finding this out. Their gift, that which they have taken for granted, is and has been their whiteness. They have gotten away with a lot. And a lot of what happened on that day they have gotten away with because of their whiteness. But those who have been arrested and thrown into jail are finding some stuff out. While some of them are being allowed to go home to their parents while they await trial, others are finding that what white privilege really is. Some of them cannot believe. They cannot believe that their whiteness is not enough to keep them from staying in jail until their trial. They cannot believe that in spite of being white, that they are being forced to live in cold cells with thin mattresses and thin blankets. They cannot believe that they are competing with cockroaches for space. And they cannot believe that they cannot get the food that they think they deserve in jail. They can't believe that their white privilege has messed with their minds. Their parents, some of them are defending them, but it's not enough. And their president, their beloved president, did not pardon them. They messed up a good thing, their privilege as white folks. Now they're sitting in jail because they took it for granted. They took it for granted that nothing would happen to them because they were white. And what they're learning at this point is not even being white can help you if you attack the United States Capitol. They might get off when they go to trial if they have trials, but at this point they are having to sit with the realization that they messed up a good thing. A second reason we mess up good things is because we don't know who we are and what we really want. In our series of Knowing Who We Are, I tried to teach that not knowing who we are causes us to do some self-damaging things while we are looking for an answer that we actually already have. We cannot accept, for example, a compliment given to us that we are attractive or intelligent or even precious in the eyes of God if we don't know who we are and what we really want. We lose opportunities, throw them away because we don't know who we are and what we really want. And we think opportunities will keep coming to us. We pursue pipe dreams that are really not our dreams, but are instead something that we saw that somebody else had. And in the process, we lose even more of ourselves. We go from job to job, denying and gnawing in our spirits that is telling us to stop and taste and see that the Lord is good and that that good God wants us to do something else. In college, we take courses that we don't even like because we don't know who we are and what we really want, or we are afraid that what we really want won't make us enough money. And so we take courses that we don't like. We spend a lot of time on spinning wheels, messing up the precious hours and days we have been given to appreciate, develop, and accept and honor who we really are and what we want. You know, we can survive that way, but we rob ourselves of the opportunity to live our fullest lives when we do that. We mess up a good thing. We do it. We were all put here for a reason, and we were given certain gifts by the Creator. And when we walk away from those things or the opportunities to work on those things, we are messing up a good thing. I was thinking the other day, what if the Reverend James Lawson, who taught the principles of nonviolent direct action in this country after having studied with Gandhi and a couple of other people, what if he had shunned the call to teach what he had learned? I don't know. I don't know that we would be here as a people. I don't know. And I don't know about him. I don't know if maybe he hadn't seen himself as a teacher of nonviolent direct action, but maybe as a prominent, well-known, well-traveled preacher, because we all want to be preachers. Maybe he wanted to be known for his preaching skills as he worked in ministry, but he got to know Gandhi and he learned how powerful it was to be nonviolent in the fight for justice. And so he went there. I don't know what he might have wanted, but he went there. He went to where his spirit was directing him. He did not know how his life would evolve, but what he did know was that the pull he felt within him was his and he respected it. He could have messed up a good thing, and it was a good thing, it turned out, for him and for us. He did not mess it up. Which leads me to a third observation. We mess up good things by trying to be somebody else. All these Republican politicians who are trying to be like the former president are a prime example of this. They are messing up whatever is good about their political lives by imitating the man who left office and who has left the country in shambles. They are adopting his propensity to lie. They are ignoring the cries of the people they say they are serving, and they are following the false god of greed for power. They might believe the stuff that they're saying, but I'm betting that they don't. I'm thinking that they're doing it for some other reasons. I don't think that they're listening to their own spiritual prodigies. I think they are ignoring their spirits and imitating this man who might be said to be leading people straight to hell and this country to ruination. They admire his power, and they want his power, but his power is not their power, and they are messing up a good thing. I can't be a Reverend Dr. Melva Sampson or Reverend Dr. Gina Stewart or Reverend Dr. Bernita Weems, all of whom are phenomenal preachers and scholars. I can only be myself. That's all I can be. You can only be yourself. You can dress like someone you admire, but you cannot be him or her. You can try to sing like Whitney Houston or Beyonce, but you are not either of those ladies. You can try to play basketball like LeBron James or football like Cam Newton or Deshaun Watson, but you cannot play their game. You have to be who you are as yourself. You are imbued with a power that is your own, but when we spend time trying to be someone else, we mess up a good thing. So that's why I'm fascinated with the story of Saul. I think it's a sad one because he clearly messes up a good thing. The Yahwists, we learned last week, got afraid because Samuel was getting old and his sons were reckless and unattentive to their needs, as Samuel had not been. Samuel had been good to them and for them. And so they were worried, and they asked Samuel to appoint over them a king like other nations. They were showing all of the reasons I just listed as reasons why we mess up good things. Their desire for a king, though, insulted God because it was God who had saved them thus far, not a king. And the scripture we read today, we see how God reminds them of how God, not a king, had saved them. But they didn't care. They wanted a king. And so God appoints Saul, a Benjamite who did not have any desire to be a king. But God chose him, and God anointed him, and God sent him. God did that. In chapter 10 of 1 Samuel, Samuel tells Saul that he will reign over the people of the Lord. Tells Saul that that's what he will do, reign over the people of the Lord, and will, quote, save them from the hands of the enemies all around. Samuel tells Saul that the people will accept him and says that, quote, the Lord will possess you and will turn you into a different person. Even though God is angry and offended at the Yahwists for rejecting him, God chooses a person to be the king that the people want. The scripture says that God gave Saul a different heart. God does this even as he reminds the people what is at risk. He reminds them that he brought them out of Egypt and rescued them from the hands of the Egyptians. He wants them to remember that because they have clearly forgotten who they are, and reminds them that they have rejected their God. God says to the people that they are to obey Saul. He says, quote, if you will fear the Lord and serve him and not rebel against the commandment of the Lord, and if both you and your king who reigns over you will follow the Lord your God, it will be well. But if you do not heed the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the commandment of the Lord, then the hand of the Lord will be against you and your king. The people are in trouble for rejecting and offending Yahweh, but Samuel tells them to just be careful and to follow the Lord with all their heart. God will make room for them, even in spite of his being offended. If they know who they are, if they are able to stop trying to be like other nations, and if they do not take God's grace and forgiveness for granted, they will be okay, both them and their king. But when we have good things, we lose ourselves too often. We do take things for granted. We do forget who we are, and we do try to be someone else. Saul couldn't believe his good fortune. He couldn't believe that God had blessed him and made him the king. It reminds me of the day that the former president said out loud in the Rose Garden shortly after he was elected a president. Can you believe that? I'll never forget that day. Saul couldn't believe that he had been so blessed. He had been a Benjamite, a nobody, and now here he was, a king. He couldn't believe he had so much power. He couldn't believe his life was so different from what it had been. He got to thinking that he was better than the blessing that he had been given, and he allowed himself to usurp the blessing giver. That was to be his downfall. There was to be a battle. Saul chose 3,000 people to fight this battle against the Philistines. He called people to fight with him. There were 30,000, though, of the Philistines. Saul had 3,000. They had 30,000. 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen and soldiers or troops. And they were like the sand. The numbers of them were like the sand on the seashore in multitude, the scripture says. The Israelites were afraid, and they should have been. There were so many of them, their enemy, and so few of them. So, you know, according to protocol, Saul was supposed to wait for 7 days to start this war. But at the end of 7 days, Samuel, who was to do the ritual necessary before fighting a war, had not come. And Saul was getting nervous. He was getting nervous because the people around him, his people, were getting afraid. They saw all these people in front of them, and they knew that they didn't have even the short number of people to compete. And so Saul said, quote, bring the burnt offerings here to me and the offerings of well-being. Now, that doesn't sound like so big a deal, except that it wasn't Saul's role. He did not know who he was. He took his position for granted, and he tried to be someone that he wasn't. In calling for the burnt offering, Saul was performing an action which was only supposed to be done by priests. The story goes that as soon as he had finished offering the burnt offering, Samuel arrived. Samuel arrived, and Saul went to meet him, and Samuel said to him, what have you done? Saul went on to explain, when I saw that the people were slipping away from me, and that you did not come within the days appointed, and that the Philistines were mustering at Michmash, I said, now the Philistines will come down upon me at Gilgal, and I have not entreated the favor of the Lord. So I forced myself and offered a burnt offering. Samuel was unimpressed and said to the king, you have done foolishly. You have not kept the commandment of the Lord, which he commanded you. The Lord, Samuel says, would have established your kingdom over Israel forever, but now your kingdom will not continue. The Lord has sought a man after his own heart. Just like that. Saul went from being an anointed of the Lord to being a loser who lost everything. He messed up a good thing. He hadn't thought that there would be consequences. He was in the house, so to speak. He thought he was special and more special than other people. God had chosen and anointed him. God had given him a new heart and made him into a different person. Saul had grown comfortable in his position and felt that he had permission to use his power as king as he wanted because he was special to God. But in doing that, he showed total disregard and disrespect and non-understanding for God. And so God took his gift away. Saul messed up a good thing. Saul continued to slip away from the protective presence of God. He continued to lose his position and power. He continued to misread and overestimate his power. He messed up a good thing. He didn't get it. That's what happens to a lot of us when we mess up a good thing. We cannot believe that our good thing is gone. Just like the singer in the Shylight song, "Have you seen it? Have you seen my blessing? Where did it go?" We look for it. We believe that we still have access to it. But when we mess up a good thing, a good blessing, the blessing we compromised and took advantage of is gone. If we mess up like that, or when we mess up like that, do we get that blessing back? No. No, the good thing we messed up is gone. Nothing will ever be the same. That blessing needed you. That blessing honored you. Once we mess up and lose it, we are changed. And therefore, we must receive a new blessing, a new good thing that usually takes some time to get to us. When we mess up a good thing, it's like our spirits have been hit by a virus which destroys important parts of us. We have to be rebuilt. We have to be retooled, given new eyes and ears and a new spirit which understands and appreciates good things. When we mess up a good thing, we put ourselves on a different growth category or in a different growth category. Old things, it says, are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. When we mess up, we must be made over so that we do not make the same mistake again. God will not put a new blessing, a new good thing in an old wine bottle, in an old backpack, in an old body, or in an old spirit. That which was, and it's over. But here is the good news. If we turn toward God and admit that we messed up the good thing that God put in our lives, if we are clear that we will not mess up, not knowingly at least, a good thing, not again should God decide to replace it, if we are clear that we realize that any good thing we have has come from God and that we will honor it as such, God will give us a second chance, another blessing. You know, there's more to the story of Saul that we're not getting to today. But today, I want us to realize that if we recognize how we managed to mess up and not do that mess up again, God will hear from heaven and God will give us a second chance. God is not like us. We offend God, but God is honored when we realize that we have offended God and work to make amends. God gave Moses and David and Rahab a second chance. God gave that one thief who hung on a cross next to him who acknowledged that he was the Son of God a second chance. And God, saints, God has given me a second chance. I messed up a good thing, a couple of good things, but God has given me a second, maybe in a third chance. And you know what? And you know what? I'm a new person because of that. When God gives you a second chance, when God lifts you up from under the weight of your mistakes, you are a new person. You don't want to mess up the good thing. But if you do, fall on your knees and give that thing to God. God will clear up your confusion about taking things for granted, not knowing who you are and trying to become somebody that you are not. God will take the fear from you that you have regarding every aspect of your life. When you mess up a good thing, remember that God is a God of second chances. And then say thank you. Don't take the new blessing and just walk off. No. Stop and tell God thank you. Tell God that you know you messed up. Tell God that you know that you didn't deserve a second chance. But tell God you are grateful that he gave it to you. Say thank you and continue to determine that you will not mess up another good thing. Not one more time. Thank God for standing with you, for waking you up in the morning, for passing you and sending you on your way. Thank God for loving you and forgiving you and receiving you and using you. And thank God, please thank God for one more chance. Amen and amen.
For a
thank you. We thank you that you are a God of seven chances. We ask you, God, that you help us to not mess up the good things that are in our lives right now. I don't know, Lord God, if somebody here is about to mess up. Lord God, help them not to do it. Help them to stop. Help them to realize what you're doing. Help them to realize that opportunities are gifts. And help us not to take our gifts for granted. Lord God, we come to you on this day because we know that we can. We know that can, we know that we can, and we know that we must. We ask you, Lord God, to hear this prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful week. I hope that God blesses you, and I hope that you realize that we have blessings, that we have good things that we should not mess up. Amen. Thank God. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Crazy Faith, for being here with us today. We hope that something in sermon or in song gave you food for thought or administered to you in some way. Let us know if there are any prayer requests. We always would love to pray for you. Our mission here at CFM is providing direct service to marginalized communities and doing justice work in the fight against injustice. So part of that work is collecting socks for the homeless. We do that throughout the year, and we need to have about 200 prayers per month to be on track to reach our goals. So if you want to help us in this endeavor, you can visit our SOC web store, which the link is in the description box, or you may email us if you would like to send us a donation of socks directly. So thank you in advance for your help. Join us tomorrow, Monday, March 8th at 6:30 p.m. for Bible study. Come learn with us, be challenged, laugh, and just grow. And please feel free to bring a friend. If you would like to help us in our outreach efforts, you can donate through our website or through Venmo or Cash App. Our Venmo is at crazy-faith. Our Cash App is Red Dip. And our website is crazyfaithministries.org. For those who aren't on Facebook but want to see a playback of our service, you can visit our church online platform at crazyfaithministries.online.church. Now, everyone, go out this week. Be safe. We love you. Thank you for tuning in with us. We hope that you continue to embody our motto and that we have come to worship and now we leave to serve. See y'all next week. Bye.